Okay. Good evening. Good evening. I'm Michael Barone, resident fellow at American Enterprise. Arthur Brooks, our president, regrets that he cannot be here. But we have obviously a good crowd here. We are going to have a presentation and at the and question and answer period. And at the end, afterwards, there'll be a reception in the hall and a book signing by the author. So we are here on the last full day of Barack Obama's seventh year as president. And we are proud to host the first public Washington event for Karl Rove, occasional campaign manager and now professional historian, and author of The Triumph of William McKinley, Why the Election of 1896 Still Matters. I first met Karl in the late 1980s in his political consultant's office in Austin, which was situated in something that looked sort of like a garden apartment complex that didn't seem to be above the flood line of a little brook that runs through the city. He was known at that time as a political consultant who helped elect the first Republican governor of Texas since Reconstruction, Bill Clements, although in Texas it's pronounced with one syllable, Clemps. Karl then was even a master of historical political demographics, and he assured me and other skeptical journalists that Texas was going to be a safe Republican state. Obviously, most of those people were skeptical, but in good time that came to pass. And with the help of sometime Rove clients like K. Bailey Hutchison, U.S. Senator for 19 years, Rick Perry, Governor of Texas for 14 years, and George W. Bush, Governor of Texas for 6 years, and President of the United States for 8. I have to confess that I've sometimes questioned Karl's political judgment. In the spring of 2000, I chided him for spending time cultivating West Virginia. I said, "You're wasting your time, Karl. That state has never gone Republican except in landslide years since 1928. Karl did not take my advice. George W. Bush carried West Virginia's 5 electoral votes, and without them, we never would have had a controversy over Florida, because Al Gore would have won 271 electoral votes and would have been the 43rd president of the United States. Karl served in the Bush White House for more than 6 years, and not only as a policy advisor, but as one who became deeply steeped in policy and government and substantive issues. But in his off hours there, and in Bush campaigns going back to 1998, he came to be a student of another Republican president who was misunderestimated by his peers and by historians of his time and later. The 25th president of the United States, William McKinley. That interest has now produced a fine book in which Karl argues that McKinley, and he makes the point that it's not just his aides, but the candidate himself, ran the first concerted campaign for a presidential nomination, beat the political establishment of his time, and then won a smashing political victory in a time of economic depression, populist protest, and presidential unpopularity, adhering to principle but also adapting to emerging issues and political circumstances. He makes a convincing case for McKinley as not only a skillful politician, but as a principled policymaker. It's consistent, convincing in part because Karl is as much a master of the intricacies of politics and the media of the 1880s and 1890s as he was of the 1980s, 1990s, and the decades since. The Triumph of William McKinley includes vivid thumbnail sketchings of multiple political players, clear descriptions of a convoluted nominating process. Thank goodness we've gotten rid of that in America today. And he keeps the reader in suspense, even though you know the outcome. So please join me in welcoming Karl Rove.
Well, hell, what else needs to be said? Thank you, Michael, for that very generous introduction. I got to inscribe a copy of my book to Michael, and I thanked him for the graduate education that I'm sure each of you went through every 2 years with the Almanac of American Politics. For decades, it's been the Bible for political junkies in America. And Michael is the heart and soul of the books that, as I was coming up in politics. I didn't set out to write a book about the 1896 election when I started this journey some number of years ago, nor when I finally wrote the book was I writing a book about this election. I was actually trying to fulfill my upper division writing requirement at the University of Texas at Austin in my 40s so I could get my BA. I was teaching at the LBJ School of Public Policy, the only Republican member of the faculty, and had gotten an offer to get into the PhD program, but there was only one requirement, which was that I finally finish my bachelor's. Needless to say, I never succeeded in doing it, but I started off this journey by looking. I wanted to understand Theodore Roosevelt in 1896. How does he go from failed New York politician who backs the wrong guy for president to in 1897 becoming the Assistant Secretary of the Navy, without which his entire future is impossible? If this doesn't happen, if he doesn't go from being on the outs to the Assistant Secretary of the Navy, we would just count him as a minor figure. And as you will see, that paper, which I did back in 1997, turned into a little bit of this book. And the simple answer is he becomes an ambitious weasel, thereby proving that sometimes greatness requires people to be ambitious weasels. But the more I got into it, the more the election of 1896 drew me, because it is one of the great five realigning elections. I'd studied it in political science from that perspective of how American politics is one way before and another way after. And yet, ironically enough, it's the only election that we don't associate with the president who brings about the realignment. We talk about the election of 1800 with Thomas Jefferson, 1828 with Andrew Jackson, 1860 with Abraham Lincoln. We talk about the New Deal of FDR in 1932. But 1896, which sets a huge change in motion in American politics, we talk more about the guy who loses the election, William Jennings Bryan, or the guy who's the ambitious weasel and follows McKinley into the White House in 1901, Theodore Roosevelt, than we do William McKinley. And Lewis L. Gould, a professor of history at the University of Texas who introduced me to McKinley, said history gets the election wrong and McKinley wrong. And he's absolutely right. And that's what drew me into this story. The more I got into it, particularly over the last 3 or 4 years when I've been writing the book, the more the politics of the era looks unintentionally like the politics of today. We have five presidential elections leading up to 1896 in which no one gets 50% of the vote. No one. We have two presidents elected with a majority in the Electoral College, but a minority of the popular vote. They lose the popular vote. And one of those involves a five-month-long dispute about the outcome in Florida. We have another president elected who wins a majority in the Electoral College and the plurality of the popular vote by 7,000. We have 20 years out of that 24 years in which there's divided government, 2 years in which the Republicans hold the White House, the House, and the Senate, 2 years in which the Democrats hold the White House, the House, and the Senate, and the other 20 years it's divided government and they hate each other. It makes today look like they're sitting around the campfire singing Kumbaya, roasting marshmallows together. Because the political battles of the Gilded Age are largely colored by the aftermath of the Civil War, in which many of these men literally fought each other on different sides of that line. And it's dysfunctional beyond belief. Nothing gets done. And the bitterness that infects American politics, the paralysis and gridlock, again, is remarkable when we look at where we're today. 1890, the Republicans take control of the House. They were civilized back then. They didn't make the Congress meet during the summers in Washington. So they come back in the fall of 1891, and the Democrats announce they will not allow a single bill to be considered by the House of Representatives by refusing to answer the roll call, denying the House a quorum. So nobody can bring up a bill. Thomas Brackett Reed, the Speaker of the House, about 6'3" tall, 300 pounds, looks sort of like a bowling pin with a walrus mustache painted on it. He takes this for about 2 or 3 days. And then announces at the end of the morning roll call, when again the quorum has not been met, He announces it to the chair and directs the clerk to count Mr. Smith present, Mr. Jones present, Mr. Fall present, Mr. Spring present. All of the Democrats milling around the floor of the House who've refused to answer the roll call. One of them stands up and says, under God and the Constitution, you have no right to count me present on the floor of the House. To which Reed, who's a pretty cool customer, says, the chair is merely stating a fact. Does the honorable gentleman from Kentucky deny he's present on the floor? This sets off a three-month-long battle about whether or not the Speaker of the House has the right to do this. The fight is ultimately won, led by Joe Cannon of Illinois and William McKinley of Ohio. Finally, the Speaker's authority is upheld. But in one of the early days of the debate, William Henry Hattie Martin of Texas stands up 6 foot 6 inches tall, mean as a snake, thin as a rail, fought through the entire Civil War under Hood in Hood's brigade. He got his nickname when Robert E. Lee reviewed the troops, and Martin, one of Hood's command officers, stood up in his stirrup, took off his hat, and waved it and said, Hattie! He stands up on the floor of the House, points to the Speaker of the House right above him, and says, if any member will order me to remove this dictator from the podium, I will do so by force forthwith. Reed says, the honorable gentleman from Texas is out of order and moves on. Martin is so irritated that he starts showing up and sitting right in front of the speaker every day thereafter during the debate, pulling out his 16-inch long Bowie knife and methodically sharpening it on his boot heel. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but I do not remember Nancy Pelosi doing this in 2011. But this was the politics of the era. There's also an economy that was going through a period of incredible disruption. There were disruptive changes in the nature of how we did things, electric lights, mechanical devices for farming and manufacture, reapers, seed drills, plows, cultivators, stamping machines, tools, dies, punches, refrigerated rail cars. Everything was going through these dramatic changes. How we did things was going through changes. We had a failed candlestick maker and a failed soap maker in Cincinnati, Ohio, who said, we need to figure out how to get consumer goods to people cheaper and faster and better. You may remember their names, Procter and Gamble. We had a company starting in Dayton, Ohio that said, let's have a cash register. We had a guy in Cleveland, Ohio, who said, you know what, I want to take everything that has to do with oil, and I want to make a totally integrated company called Standard Oil, John D. Rockefeller, and I'm going to thereby drive down the price of the goods and services that come out of oil so that more people have access to it. Incredible disruptions that were moving through the economy. And they were causing two things to simultaneously happen. Growing concern about people's place in the economy, insecurity. I'm a farmer. I used to be happy growing a crop, feeding my family, and taking what else I didn't eat to market, and I worried about the prices that came from the next county or the next state. But now I'm a farmer, and I'm working in a world economy, and I'm going to be affected. The price of what I'm going to get paid is going to be affected by the wheat crop in Australia, or what happens in the harvest in Ukraine, or what happens to demand in Argentina. There's also insecurity. And I'm an artisan. I make things with my hands. And now I'm competing with a machine that stamps out the same thing that I make mechanically, second after second, uniformly and in a way that makes it difficult for me to compete. Will my skill be worth anything in the future that appears to be coming today? We have a growing concern about inequality because a lot of people are being crammed into tenements in our urban areas are thrown out onto the prairies and living in shacks and hovels and sod houses. And yet we see in every bit of our lives enormous wealth in the Gilded Age, people of extravagant means. And the concern is, am I being treated fairly? I'm a new farmer, and I get a mortgage, which is hard to get in those days. And in an era of essentially low, flat interest rates, the farmer who has a mortgage is paying some insurance company or some specialized mortgage company put together by the Eastern Money Power. They're paying 9% to 14% interest rates. And there's a growing concern that's dividing America between those who think they're being put upon by the Eastern financial power and those that seem to benefit from the concentration of money and finance on the East Coast. And then we're going through demographic changes, big demographic changes as a country. We were a nation of immigrants. We'd always been a nation of immigrants. But now the immigration in the aftermath of the Civil War is coming from new and different places. Less of it from the familiar places like Germany and England and Scotland and Wales and Ireland. And now coming from these weird places. We have Ukrainian wheat farmers and Polish tailors, and we have Spanish tanners and Italian potters. And then we got these really weird people coming from the north of Europe, from Norway, Sweden, and God, even Finland. And this is causing a big change in America's culture and America's politics, because these people and their forebears were not here at the time of the Civil War. They did not vote as they shot because their people weren't here, and they weren't here. And as a result, both political parties, because of these changes, because of the gridlock of American politics during the Gilded Age, and because of the economic changes that were roiling through our society, and because of these new waves of immigrants who were confronting the old political system, both parties are under grave pressure. The Republicans are surviving in the presidential race only by adding what Marcus Alonzo Hanna once called coyote patches in the West. Because the Republican vote in the South is being wiped out. After 1876, not a single electoral vote from the South goes to the Republicans. Even though we have in 1896 at least two and probably four states in which an absolute majority of the population are black men who are voting overwhelmingly Republican. But in none of those states did the Republicans come close in 1896, because for 30 years, through violence, intimidation, and fraud, the black vote in the South and the white Republican vote are being kept from either voting or having their votes counted fairly. The Democratic Party, on the other hand, is becoming increasingly a party of the South and of the rural agrarians in the Midwest, and is not being able to make a strong connection with these new immigrant groups. Sure, the Irish were Democrat, and sure, to a lesser extent, the Poles and the Bohemians were. But these new groups are not tied to either structure, and the Democrats, increasingly dominated as they are by Southern men like Pitchfork Ben Tillman or James Jones of Arkansas, aren't finding a very warm welcome in these new urban communities. Democrats also have a burden leading into this year in that they have a Democrat president and the country's in depression. This led the Democrats, starting in 1895, to split, because inside the Democratic Party for 30 years has been a growing sense that the country needed to have an inflationary currency. Sort of hard for us to understand what this is all about today. Sort of hard for us to understand the battle between those who favored a gold standard and those who favored a silver standard. But the silver standard was advocated by the men who stood for the common man, for the masses. And this revolt starts in the summer of 1895 in a way that looks vaguely familiar to those of us who have seen the civil rights movement and the anti-war movement, and to a lesser extent, the Goldwater movement, work their way through both political parties. This is more like the first two, the anti-war and the civil rights movement working their way through the Democratic Party, than it is the Goldwater movement, because this is about an idea, not a man. The silver Democrats literally say, let's not talk about a candidate until we have got the platform right. And once the platform is right in favor of the free and unlimited coinage of silver, then and only then should we contend over who the nominee ought to be. And they take on, beginning in the summer of 1895, the entrenched Cleveland Democrats, the gold men who dominate the regular Democratic Party, and in convention after convention after convention, the insurgents throw out Cleveland's men and repudiate explicitly the sitting Democratic president. They not only do it merely in platforms and resolutions that condemn his actions by name, but they do it with a personal ferocity that's pretty funny to read about now. I guess it wasn't funny at the time when in Ohio, a Democrat stands up and says, you have a picture of Cleveland hanging on the wall. He says, that is the traitor, the Benedict Arnold, the Democratic Party, rip it down now. And the convention roars its approval, and someone pulls down the portrait of Cleveland and shreds it. At the Indiana Democratic Convention, the invocator, a local Protestant minister, makes the mistake of calling for, quote, divine protection for the president, and is booed and heckled by Democrats, one of whom stands up and says, "I demand you retract your request." The success of the Silverman, however, in nominating one of their own at the Democratic convention gives the Democrats an enormous advantage going into the election, because it made the Democratic Party the party of change. Now suddenly it was not Cleveland and the gold Democrats. It was now the Silverman who dominated the Democratic Party and had this alluring call for an inflationary currency that would put more money into the pockets of the working man and the farmer. It relieved the Democratic Party of the responsibility for the Depression by repudiating not only the policies, but the man who had made those policies. And it made the Republican Party temporarily look like the party of the status quo. After all, the Republicans at their convention endorsed the gold standard, the very standard that the Democrats had, the Silverman blamed for the economic condition of the country. And that action itself split the Republicans, because guess where the silver in America came from? It came from those coyote patches out west. It came from Idaho and Montana and Nevada and Colorado and Utah. And the silver spirit infected not only the men in the mining region, but the men in the Midwestern agricultural region, where there were a lot of people who didn't own their farms but instead had mortgages, particularly Kansas and Nebraska and the Dakotas. Now, this is not simply, however, a tale. The more I got into it, this is not simply a tale of big economic forces making their way through our culture, our economy, and our politics. This is a story with sex, violence, backstabbing, betrayal, deception, fraud, courage, compassion, surprising twists and turns, and most important of all, really cool nicknames. Everybody in this era has a cool nickname. The Napoleon of Protection is the Republican nominee. The boy orator of the Platte is the Democratic nominee. We have several cyclones. We have Cyclone Davis of Texas, a Democrat populist, and the Southern Cyclone, Henry Clay Evans of Tennessee, a Republican. What's not to like about an election in which you've got somebody named the blonde boss, the easy boss, and most important of all, the Democratic frontrunner for president? Richard Park Bland of Missouri, who for 20 years has led the fight for the free and unlimited coinage of silver. His nickname is Silver Dick. What's not to like about an election like that? And at the center of it is this completely unappreciated political leader named William McKinley. First of all, I thought I knew about McKinley. You probably thought you knew about him too, but forget it. You know nothing about him. I didn't know anything about him. The more I read about him, the more I knew of my ignorance. We honor JFK for PT 109. We honor 41 for enlisting at the age of 18 and becoming a Navy fighter pilot, the youngest in World War II. We honor Bob Dole for storming the beaches at Anzio and being gravely wounded. William McKinley enters the Civil War in April of 1861 as a private with the 23rd Ohio. He's in the Poland militia. Young men who show up outside of Columbus, Ohio, at Camp Jackson, and they're going to enlist for 90 days. Lincoln has called for 90-day enlistments. When they arrive, however, they're told the quota has been filled. Your choice is enlist for 3 years or the duration, whichever is longer, or go home. And almost to a man, the men of the Poland militia enlist and become the 23rd Ohio. McKinley, at the end of the war, however, is not Private McKinley. He is Major McKinley, having been given 3 battlefield promotions for unbelievable bravery, 2 suicide missions, the first of which he chooses for himself at Antietam, the bloodiest day of the war, where he is safely behind the front lines, the commissary sergeant, who watches his fellow comrades go into battle at 2 a.m. in the morning to take the Stone Bridge. Those of you who are Civil War buffs have seen a picture or maybe even visited the Stone Bridge. At 2 p.m. in the afternoon, after 12 hours of continual fighting, the 23rd has participated in the taking of the Stone Bridge and is now comfortably across the bridge and sheltered under a bluff. And McKinley has watched them fight for the 700 or 800-yard open field to approach the bridge and take the bridge for 12 hours. And he's worried that his comrades have had neither water nor food. So when the supply train shows up, he commandeers a wagon, loads it with big tins of coffee, tins of boiled meat, whatever that was, and hardtack, and makes his way through a through a forest to the front lines and is twice ordered to retire and return by officers who ask him what he's doing. One of them says to him, "That's a killing field. The only thing you're going to cross in that field are dead bodies," and orders him back. And twice he disobeys their orders and finally bursts out of the tree line, whipping his horses or mules. I come down on the side of horses. Be happy to describe the detailed review and investigation I did on that critical question. Whips his horses and comes rolling out and out, and all hell breaks loose. Literally, a cannon shell takes off the back of the wagon. Somehow or another, he is not killed. And it must have been an incredible sight because people wrote about it as he came across the stone bridge, and the men of the 23rd realized it was their commissary sergeant. They stood as one and cheered. As he made his way through the wounded, he handed a cup of coffee to a grievously wounded comrade who said to him, "God bless you, lad." It's probably the last cup of coffee that guy had. McKinley said it was the greatest gift he could have ever received, the greatest praise he could have ever received. He is recommended for the Congressional Medal of Honor and tells his comrades, don't. I was only doing my duty. His second suicide mission, he's ordered on. By the 2 years later, at the Battle of Kernstown in the Shenandoah Valley, his brigade commander orders him on a suicide mission when Jubal Early's Confederates begin to crumple the Union left, the front line, and the five regiments under the control of this particular brigade commander, four of them have received the order to retreat, but somehow or another, on the extreme right of the Union front line, the 13th West Virginia has not gotten the order, and they're in an orchard, they're about ready to be cut off and shot to pieces by the Confederates. So First Lieutenant McKinley is ordered to ride in front of the Union lines diagonally across the battlefield to alert the 13th to get the hell out of there. His tent mate says it was a suicide mission. At one point, as he's riding over this battlefield, a shell goes off right near him and they think he's gone. And then his tent mate, Russell Hastings, later wrote, out of the gray cloud of smoke came the small brown horse with the erect horseman. Somehow or another, McKinley makes it to the 13th West Virginia just in time, and they line up, march through the orchard, take one shot at the Rebs, and then beat the hell out of there. He rides behind the Union lines, walks into his brigade commander's tent. His brigade commander turns around and looks at him and is startled. His brigade commander, Colonel Rutherford B. Hayes, says, "My God, I never expected to see you in this life again." He's an unbelievably effective member of Congress because he kept his mouth shut and did his homework. So when he spoke, people actually paid attention to him. And he was well prepared and an effective debater and a man who had his act together. And his colleagues, whether they were Democrats or Republicans, liked him. One thing I found out about the Gilded Age that blew my mind was, in this period, if your party lost control of the House and you had had a close election, you got thrown out. And McKinley, in 1882, wins re-election by 7 votes. And he knows he's a marked man. Republicans did it to Democrats, and Democrats did it to Republicans. So he's sworn in provisionally, but he's under an election challenge. And sure enough, in early 1884, the wheels ground slowly, but they ground on him, and he got kicked out. But when he gets kicked out, 7 Democrats do the unthinkable, and that is they cross party lines and vote to keep him in. And among them are his most ardent opponents on the issue of protection. The leading free trade Democrats, including Roger Q. Mills of Texas, vote to keep him in. Why? Because they found him a worthy adversary, a worthy opponent, and they developed enormous respect for him. Thomas Brackett Reed complained about him once. He said, "My opponents in Congress go after me tooth and nail, but they feel obliged to apologize to William before they criticize him." And this was the nature of the man. He could be an intense partisan and a very effective advocate, but he was a man who drew the respect of opponents and friends alike, fellow Republicans alike, because of the quality of his mind and the quality of his character. Now, what we think about him is that he's a tool, that he is the puppet of Marcus Alonzo Hanna. The opposite is true. Think of Hanna as Don Evans, the good friend of the candidate who wants to do everything possible to help get him elected. But he's not the guy in charge. In fact, if you take a look at the critical decisions that occurred during this campaign, almost inevitably, Hannah is wrong-minded. The guy who understands what needs to be done and how it needs to be done is the guy in charge, William McKinley. The best way to understand Hannah is to remember a favorite quote of his, Herman Kohlstedt, the Swedish baker in Chicago who made a bunch of money and bought newspapers with his money, once said of Hannah, he said, to understand Hannah and McKinley's relationship, you have to remember that Hannah is like the bashful boy towards the girl he loves. And the guy who used to laugh about that comment and repeat it was Hannah himself, because he thought it was true about his relationship with McKinley. McKinley instead is not the cipher, not the puppet, not the tool. He's instead a man who understands the nature of the country, understands the nature of the campaign, and has a keen eye for talent. And he makes big decisions in his campaign. And Hannah is not even the campaign manager. We think of him as the man who ran the campaign, but he doesn't run the campaign. I traced Hannah's travel. During the 118 days of the general election, Mark Hanna is away from the headquarters in Chicago for 70 of the days. Instead, the campaign manager turns 31 during the course of the campaign. McKinley has met him 4 years before, when the kid is a young lawyer practicing law in Lincoln, Nebraska, and comes to Columbus, Ohio to say to Governor McKinley, if you run for president, I want to help you. In January of 1895, he moves to Illinois. Kid's decided to become an entrepreneur. He's turned 29, and he's going to move to Chicago and become an entrepreneur. And Chicago is the political center of the most important Republican presidential primary contest of the season, Illinois. One of McKinley's advisors calls it the Gettysburg of the contest. So what does McKinley do? He puts the 29-year-old in charge of his campaign in the state of Illinois and gives him as his lieutenants two older men, 30 years his senior, both of whom are Illinois natives and who are Civil War generals, and they take to calling their 29-year-old boss the general because they like him so much, because he's such a natural leader. He looks weird, red hair parted exactly in the middle, red mustache. His favorite profane expression is to say Hellfire and Maria. He smokes a corncob pipe with the corncob mostly sideways, so he's always covered with burning tobacco. But he's incredibly methodical. And he has a card file in which he keeps track of every single delegate in every one of the 102 counties in the state, and is directing these two senior guys and one other young guy who's working with him to go to Logan County because we're coming up short, or go to Christian County because we need to have five more delegates, or you need to go to the 9th Congressional District and here's where our weak points are, all in a card file that he keeps in his office in Auditorium Hotel. And when he goes to the state convention, where the bad guys, the Combine, as they call themselves, are led by the blonde boss of Chicago, William J. Larmer. The bosses anticipate that they're going to win this and win this easily, and instead they are dealt a deadly blow. They lose 2-1. And every major newspaper in America says the Republican presidential contest is now over. It's completely over. We're shocked. We don't know how, but McKinley has prevailed in the heart of the beast, and the contest is over. And that night, McKinley sits down and writes a letter to the young 31-year-old. And it's a beautiful handwritten letter. He says, I cannot close the day without sending you a message of appreciation and congratulations, he says to Charles G. Dawes. There is nothing in all of this long campaign so signal and significant as the triumph at Springfield. I cannot find words to express my admiration for your high qualities of leadership. You have won exceptional honor. You had long ago won my heart. McKinley never had a son. His two infant daughters die, one at a matter of a few months and one at the age of five. And Charles G. Dawes, who goes on to become the comptroller of the currency at the age of 32, first director of the very first Bureau of the Budget under Warren G. Harding, vice president under Calvin Coolidge, ambassador to Great Britain, head of the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, and the fourth American to win the Nobel Peace Prize. When McKinley meets him, he's a 29-year-old lawyer in Lincoln, Nebraska, who practices law in the same small office building with a young lawyer 5 years his senior named William Jennings Bryan. And the two men often have lunch with another pal of theirs at Cameron's, a 15-cent diner, the young ROTC instructor at the University of Nebraska, John J. Pershing. But in 1894, McKinley sees this kid and says he's got talent. And he becomes part of what is the first modern primary campaign in American history. Before, presidential contests were basically settled at the convention. You got your home state and a couple of other states, and you showed up at the convention, at least on the Republican side, and you cut deals. You made deals over patronage and cabinet posts and money, and you put together enough people, and generally, if you were the second choice, that was the best place to be. The front runner in 1860 doesn't win, Chase. It goes to everybody's second choice on the third ballot, the lanky lawyer from Illinois, Lincoln. Takes 36 ballots in 1880. There's only one convention between 1856 for the Republicans and 1896 in which there are two conventions in which there is only one ballot. 1868 with Ulysses S. Grant and then the renomination of Harrison in 1892. Otherwise, it's multi-ballots. And McKinley said, I'm not going to do it that way. I'm going to win it all on the first ballot, and I'm going to do that by systematically organizing in every single state. I will use my friendships from Congress and my relationships with Ohioans who have dispersed themselves and from people that I've met by campaigning for the Republicans and by people that I can win through my cause through personal suasion, and I will get a majority of the vote on the first ballot, and I will do so by making not a single promise about patronage or cabinet posts. I want to go, he said, to the White House unmortgaged. He's also, during this process, the first presidential candidate in either party to openly campaign in front of black audiences and ask for their votes. And he does so not in the comfortable North, but in Savannah, Georgia, and Jacksonville, Florida, in March of 1895. We have really two interesting conventions. Very different, but both of them interesting. We have a Republican convention where everything is settled in the battle for over credentials disputes. Of the 900 and some odd delegates to the Republican National Convention, 141 of them are challenged in credentials, including all 30 from Texas. And that's because the Texas convention deteriorated into a race riot that led to 500 McKinleyites storming 300 combine men, led by the African-American leader of the Texas Republican Party, Norris Wright Cuny, and beating the crap out of each other for 20 minutes until the town marshal in Austin, Texas, came and broke it up. I recently spoke in Austin at the Austin Club, which used to be called the Millett Opera House and was the site of the riot in 1896. It was a lot of fun. But at this convention, the Republican bad guys, the Combine, find out, much to their dismay, that they've lost control of the Credentials Committee and the RNC, and McKinley wins the convention before the convention ever starts. But it also has a walkout where the Republicans openly split at the convention with the Western Silvermen led by Henry Moore Teller, literally who helped found the territorial Republican Party of Colorado, walk out of the convention. And of course, then the Democrats have their famous convention. And the Cross of Gold speech is a result of seven accidents. Nobody considers Bryan a serious contender for the presidency. Nobody. On the morning of the convention itself, when he's about ready to give the speech, the David Broder of his time, a man named Francis E. Lepp, is writing for the evening paper in New York, and he's writing his column, and two seasoned Democrats are sitting on either side of him. Well, one seasoned Democrat and one other journalist are sitting on the other side of him. And they're looking over his shoulder as he writes, and he says, the Democrats are looking for a Moses. And if the moment is right and he gets them, Bryan could be the coming man. And both these guys are completely discombobulated. He said, he's not a candidate. Are you kidding us? Please. You're going to embarrass yourself. We don't even know what he looks like. And Lepp says, points across the Coliseum, and says he's a young man in the black alpaca coat sucking on a lemon. Bryan is about ready to give the Cross of Gold speech, and they don't even know what he looks like. And he's giving the speech because of seven accidents that occur in the 2 days leading up to the speech itself. And the last accident has just happened. And if any of these accidents had gone a different direction, these accidents of history, William Jennings Bryan would not have been in the moment and could not have given the famous speech, a speech which, incidentally, he thinks he's failed at. At the end of the speech, he is He's a couple of days before he'd given a paid speech in Crete, Nebraska. And he used a line that he'd used in a congressional debate a couple of years before, and the response was so good to it, he thought, if I get a chance to speak, I ought to use that. And so he does, to close his speech. As he said, "You shall not press down upon the brow of labor this crown of thorns." He moved his hands down the sides of his head, his fingers slowly drawing invisible spikes about his temples, blood dripping from the scratches. He then proclaimed, "You shall not crucify mankind on a cross of gold." Arms thrust out at right angles, chest forward and head back, the crucified man personified. He held this pose for a few moments, then his arms fell to his side, he stepped back, and his chin dropped. A second or so later, he straightened, turned, and walked off the stage, the hall in what the Atlanta Constitution called fearful silence. The Coliseum was quiet a moment more, and then exploded. Men and women jumped on their chairs screaming, arms and fists striking at the air. Hats sailed skyward or were waved along with handkerchiefs, flags, canes, fans, umbrellas, newspapers, and coats, anything that could be grabbed and flourished. I never dreamed that a mortal man could so grip and fill with enthusiasm thousands of men, Josephus Daniels later wrote. The floor and the galleries were a mass of frenzied throngs of shouters beside themselves, all with one speech and all an accident. And yet, into the general election go the two parties, with the Democrats clearly with the momentum in the race. They not only have a candidate who has appeared from nowhere and grabbed the attention of America, not only has he exemplified a new economic philosophy that gives hope to so many, but the Democrats also have an advantage in the Electoral College. They have the solid South with 111 votes. They have 47 votes in the border states that they've won every election since the Civil War, and they have 29 electoral votes in the Rocky Mountain West that they've stolen from the Republicans that even the Republicans admit are gone, for a total of 187, and all they need is 224. And the Republicans have the 138 electoral votes they've won in each of the last five elections. And they go into the election. And it's not only the traditional battleground states of Indiana, Ohio, New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut. But it's also the industrial Midwest. Essentially every state around Illinois is up for grabs. And there's no straight line to the general election. We now look back and say McKinley won, therefore we knew that he was going to win from the beginning. But there's no straight line. There are twists and turns for both parties. And both of them mount extraordinary campaigns. Brian travels 18,000 miles, three quarters of the way around the world, on a train, appearing before audiences, sometimes giving 16 speeches a day. 2 to 3 million people show up and see him. And most of the time that he's on that train until October 7th, he is literally getting up in the morning, buying his own train ticket most days, sitting in a common car, grabbing a sandwich whenever he can from a depot snack shop, and hoping that somebody has a hotel room for him at the end of the day. It's not until the 7th of October that he gets his own private rail car. And McKinley has the front porch campaign in which 750,000 people come to Canton, Ohio, and come across his lawn. And the entire campaign, I mean, there are October surprises. The Democrats manufacture one, and the Republicans benefit from one. And both of them are aimed at basically the same group of people, industrial laborers and farmers in the Midwest. And at the end of the day, and I'll quickly bound through this, I believe McKinley wins because of eight simple things. One is he makes the campaign about big issues. It's not about small ball. Both men want to talk about big things, particularly money. And when we talk about currency back then, they knew what they were talking about, and they were informed. But it's hard for us to grasp what it's about. But actually, Brian did a good job of explaining exactly what it was about in two simple sentences in the Cross of Gold speech. Let me read them to you and see if you understand what they might mean. Or maybe you've heard them before. There are two ideas of government. Republicans believe if you just legislate to make the well-to-do prosperous, then their prosperity will leak through on those below them. Democrats believe if you legislate to make the masses prosperous, their prosperity will find its way up and through every class that rests upon it. And both men agreed with this. Both men agreed that this was what it was about. and they both set out to make it a campaign about this. But McKinley took on Bryan's strength, arguing on behalf of free silver as a way to make the masses prosperous in order to have the prosperity rise through up through every class above it, and went at his supposed strength and turned it into a weakness. And he did so by articulating conservative economic principles in a way that appealed to the working man. Took him a while to get there. He didn't start off doing it right. Took him until mid-September, aided by the former head of the Knights of Labor and by Theodore Roosevelt to get the right language. But he eventually finds the right language and begins to make the argument. And at the end of the campaign, sweeps the laboring vote, wins the city of New York, wins the factory districts of Baltimore, wins the stockyards of Chicago, all because he finds a way to talk about this in a way that gets to the heart of the issue and in the minds of laboring people. He modernized the Republican Party. The Republican Party before McKinley is a party in the North of white Anglo-Saxon Protestants. He becomes the first Republican presidential candidate to be endorsed by a member of the Catholic hierarchy. And he invites to Canton, Ohio, this wild conglomeration of new immigrant groups and first-time voters and industrial workers, you know, Croatian miners and Portuguese sponge fishermen and German and Hungarian glass workers, and all these people come to Canton, Ohio, and meet with the major. And out of this, he creates a coalition for the Republican Party that consists not only just of the white Anglo-Saxon Protestants who'd historically been the party's strength in the North, plus some Germans. Instead, it's a frothy coalition of all these new immigrant groups. He did that in part also to broaden the battlefield. He wins these four out of the five border states, Kentucky, West Virginia, Maryland, and Delaware, all of which the Democrats had won since the Civil War. And in part, particularly in Delaware and Maryland and West Virginia, he does so by making inroads among these new immigrant groups. He runs as an outsider, not bound by the practices of his era. Sure, he's an establishment politician because he's a member of Congress, but he's also the first Republican or Democrat who says, I'm going to run for my nomination as a candidate attempting to win and reflect the views of ordinary party members, not the party bosses. He becomes a candidate of change by melding this message of conservative economics and protectionism to say, I will bring about a change in America's economy, and makes a convincing case for it. And he runs a campaign that is modern and almost industrial in scale. It is a high quality campaign that does things that we take for granted today that were undone and not known at the time. They print 250 million pieces of material and distribute them. Literally carloads of material leave Chicago bound for headquarters across the country. 18 pieces of material for every voter. They have voter groups for everybody, from blacks and women and Germans to you name it. They print the material in 14 different languages. They even organize a group to attract young voters, young men, because there's a craze sweeping the country. Bicycles. So they have the wheelmen for McKinley. And literally on one day in October, dozens of bicycle clubs come to Canton. One of them is a band that plays while it rides. They conduct these elaborate displays in front of the major because this is a craze sweeping the country. The other day I actually got a wheelman for McKinley button. It's pretty cool. But he also wins because he's a unifier. And this is where I'll close. Bryan is angry. Bryan is dividing the country. When he goes to accept the Democratic nomination at Madison Square Garden, he announces at Lincoln, Nebraska, that I go into the enemy's country. If you're not with him, you're against him. If you're a Democrat who questions him, you will have to return, he says, in sackcloth and ashes. He takes to excoriating McKinley men who show up at his rallies. This is entertainment back then. Democrats would go to Republican rallies, and Republicans would go to Democratic rallies. And when he would spot somebody wearing a gold ribbon or a McKinley badge, he would excoriate them by saying they're dupes of the money power, of the idle capital of Wall Street and the bondmen of Lombard Street. These are constant refrain in his speeches. Now, the Republicans had some tough rhetoric, particularly from Theodore Roosevelt. But McKinley's rhetoric is that of a national unifier. We're all in this together. We will rise as one. We should not pit labor and capital against each other because our success is intimately tied. One cannot succeed without the prosperity of the other. And he does this not only in words, but in actions. One of my favorite moments of the campaign is October 9th, 1896. 40 train carloads of men arrive in Canton, Ohio, early in the day, and off walk 2,000 men in butternut or gray uniforms and their families, 2,000 Confederate veterans from the Shenandoah campaign in which he fought. These were the men on the other side of the same guns. Same lines have divided them, man against man, brother against brother. And it is the first time that a Republican presidential candidate or president has ever met with a group of Confederate veterans. The 2,000 men are met by the Grand Army of the Republic Honor Guard, by a mounted escort, by bands. The wives of the Grand Army of the Republic have made a beautiful silk banner for them to commemorate the day. The local knife company, Novelty Knife Company of Canton, Ohio, has made a knife for each one of them with a favorite phrase of the major, of Major McKinley on it. Taken from Washington's farewell address, no east, no south, no east, no west, no north, no south, but a common country. They're all given a badge, half blue, half gray, with a red, white, and blue rosette at the top, and imprinted on the badge is the same phrase, and at the bottom is a chromolith of McKinley and Hobart, his running mate. I got one the other day. I was at an event, and a guy came up and said, I read your book, I read about the badge, I thought you'd like it. 2,000 of them were made, and I got one of them. Well, these veterans line up, they're fed lunch first, they're waiting for some comrades who are late, and they then line up with the Union veterans. Men in blue, men in gray, mingled together as units, led by bands, an honor guard, and flags, and they march up North Market Street to the major's home. And the newspapers of the time and a couple of letters painted an unbelievable picture. Because as they march up this street, the streets are lined by thousands upon thousands of people, waving flags, singing patriotic songs, and many of them openly weeping at the sight of blue and gray together, the country united. I read all of McKinley's speeches, so you can sort of tell when he's speaking off the cuff and when he's speaking from prepared remarks. And this day, he has clearly thrown away the remarks. And he speaks from the heart. He says, sectionalism was surrendered at Appomattox. Not part of our country, but sectionalism. And we are all together. He says, if we are ever forced to fight again, and God forbid that we are, we will fight as brothers together under a common flag. And at the end of this moving presentation, the 2,000 veterans, Confederate veterans, line up and make their way across his front porch and shake the great man's hand, then return to the tabernacle to be fed dinner, and then their bands give a concert in the courthouse square until midnight, when they are escorted by thousands of Canton residents to the trains and board their trains back to Virginia. And this is a huge moment for the country. You know, I didn't write this to be a 2016 book. I wrote this to be a history of the 1896 book. But I do think in the conduct of McKinley, there's something to be said about what can be done. Because here's a man who united the country, becomes the first president since Ulysses S. Grant to get a majority of the popular vote. And when he becomes president, he acts in concert with what he said he would do during the campaign, and thereby creates a durable Republican majority coalition that lasts for 36 years. During those 36 years, the Republicans control the Senate for 30, the White House for 28, the House for 26. We have more governors and state legislatures than we do until 90 years later, until 2011. And most of the mayors of most major cities in the North during this period of time, Boston, New York, Philadelphia, Cleveland, Cincinnati, Chicago, St. Louis, even Los Angeles and San Francisco, most of the mayors during this period for most of the era are Republicans. Anyway, I've prattled on for too long. I'd be happy to answer a couple of questions. I hope you enjoy the book.
Well, thank you very much, Karl, for a wonderful presentation and bringing us back to 1896 and indeed we didn't know for sure that McKinley was going to win when you were halfway there. So I invite questions. I would ask questioners to ask questions, not make lengthy comments. Wait for the microphones, which will be coming about, and state your name and affiliation, please. So let us see. Let's see. Michael's there. Here. Oh. No, you, go ahead. Oh. Claude Marx.
Okay. what do you want to your book? Two quick questions. What prompted McKinley to do the porch front campaign as opposed to campaigning? And secondly, what was his relationship with William Howard Taft? I know he plucked Taft from the court to put him to send him to the Philippines later on. But talk about that dynamic also, please.
Well, first of all, on the front porch campaign, it's actually an accident. What happens is people start showing up. And at first, McKinley is completely discombobulated by it because he's trying to get his, he's trying to write his acceptance speech, which was a big deal. You know, you got notified, even though you read it in the papers, they would notify you. And then you were supposed to sit for a couple of weeks and formally decide whether or not you're going to accept the nomination and do so. And he's worried about making his acceptance speech, drafting it properly. And people are just sort of showing up. So what happens is, Hannah gets it wrong. I mean, the Republicans are now suddenly completely upset and nervous as hell because back then they didn't have polls. They conducted the canvass, which meant that every precinct chairman had to go find out what everybody in their precinct, where they were, and report it to the county, which would then aggregate the results for the county and report it to the state, which would then aggregate them and send them on to the national campaign. And what happened is in July and August, the Republican canvasses, particularly in the Midwest, are showing that huge defections over silver. H.G. McMillan, the Iowa chairman, sends a letter saying, we're going to lose 25% of the farm vote. We will be utterly wiped out in the state. We'll lose a quarter of our Republican farmers. So Hannah starts saying, you know what, you need to get going. You need to go around the country and travel. And McKinley... McKinley didn't want to do this. Nobody had really done it before. Garfield goes on the road, he gives six speeches. Six. And most of the time you just sort of sat at home, gave your acceptance speech, and everybody else went out and did your business. And Hannah says, you got to go on the road. Like you did in 1894 during the midterm election, you got to go out and spend. McKinley had done nearly 8,000 miles in 1894. And what happened is that... let me see, these are a couple of great quotes here. They go to him and say, you got to go do this. And he said, no, I can't do that. I got to think before I talk. And they said, well, you know, Brian's out there speaking. You got to go. He says, look, I can't keep up. If I go and I sit in a Pullman car, he's going to sit in a common car. I sit in a common car, he's going to be in a freight car. You know, I sit in the freight car, and he's going to sit on the open car. You know, and Dawes goes to him, and he says, well, you know, I can't work on a trapeze. I can't compete with this guy. So he's the guy who starts, they start methodically doing this, and it's industrial in nature, and you can see McKinley in it, because they invite groups, they ask you, or they get word that you're coming, and they say, what are you going to say? We don't want any mistakes. So send us what you're going to say when you meet the major on his front lawn. And then the major writes up his own remarks in response, so they're localized, so that when they get repeated in the newspaper back in Pennsylvania or New York or Illinois or wherever, they're going to have a local flavor to them. And it's methodical. And they got it down on an art form. They know exactly where they're going to take them. After you visit with the major, they take you to a place where you're going to be fed. If you're wet, they've got discreetly a couple of beers for you. And if you're a dry, they've got a sandwich and a cup of coffee. But, I mean, this is it's industrial in nature, but it's the first time it's ever done, and it's done by accident because they keep showing up, and finally McKinley says, we got to get this thing organized.
Let's see. Let's try another question there. John?
Gizzy.
Yes.
Shout it out, man. You got a big voice.
Okay. Thank you, Michael, and thank you, Carl.
John Gizzy,
chief political correspondent and White House correspondent for Newsmax. Carl, first of all, thank you very much for the presentation. You've brought McKinley and Silver Dick and others to life, actually. I I'm tempted to ask if you see a McKinley and a Charles Dawes in the current field right now, but I know you won't answer that. So my question is this. I'm fascinated that McKinley appealed to immigrants, and particularly those who were very incongruous in the United States, the Portuguese, the Croatian, with Congress giving the green light and the funding for refugees coming from the Middle East. Do you see this as a potential base of support for a Republican candidate? And if so, how does he or she do it?
Yeah, well, first of all, those refugees aren't going to be coming here and voting. These were voters. These were people who had come here, established themselves, had become citizens, and were eligible to vote. And the interesting thing is McKinley went against type when he did this, because, again, this is not done. Republicans were, you know, white Anglo-Saxon Protestants. And along comes McKinley. You know who opens the Republican convention the first day? Rabbi Sale of St. Louis. Who opens it the second day? Bishop Arnett of Ohio, African-American Methodist preacher, AME preacher. When Bishop Ireland, in October, the Catholic Bishop of St. Paul, issues an open letter endorsing McKinley, it's like jaw-dropping, because remember, what's the largest interest group in America? 13 million members at its height. The American Protective Association, which is a virulently anti-Catholic, anti-immigrant group. And here's McKinley. He is the only Republican presidential candidate in 1896 that the APA declares is unacceptable. And it's because of his openness. They had pressured him. When he ran for re-election as governor of Ohio in 1893, they had called him up. He'd won election by 20,000 votes. They have 63,000 members in Ohio. They have a voter's guide, which is religiously followed by APA members in voting. And they say to him, they call him up on a Friday and say, there are two Catholic guards at the state penitentiary. You need to fire these men. And this is a test. We'll call you back Monday. And Monday they call McKinley back and he says, we have no religious test for office under the Constitution. The men will keep their jobs. They leave him off the APA guide. Now, fortunately, Hannah hears about this and tells a couple of Catholic priests about it. And several weeks later, 10 days later, the bishops of Cincinnati and Cleveland announced that McKinley has done an excellent job as governor, as a worthy public servant, tantamount to an endorsement. But this is unheard of for him to get the endorsement of the Catholic, of a member of the Catholic hierarchy as a Republican. But he knows what's happening in the country and says, these people share our values and our principles. Why not get them? They're our kind of voters. Did I dodge your question enough, John? Yeah, good. Yes. Thank you. Thanks.
Let's try over there next to him.
Thanks. Good evening. I'm Patrick Wilson. I'm from Independence, Missouri.
There we go.
We like history, too. So I was struck as an Army guy myself that a lot of what your narrative in the book breaks out is McKinley's tremendous, I guess we call it strategic patience. He waited and learned and went to many conventions. And I wonder, we live in a time, and everyone's thinking about the 2016 election, where we have a lot of men in a hurry, some women too. And I'm wondering what you think about lessons for strategic patience.
Yeah. Well, you're right. He this is a guy who knew that he wasn't the smartest guy in the room and never thought that. And as a result, he was open to learning. And he doesn't want to go to the 1884 convention. Doesn't want to go. He's become, because they kicked him out of Congress and because he has been such an effective leader on a weird issue, he has led the fight in the Congress to stop Democratic efforts to gut Southern voting rights. And he's become a national, because of these two things, he's become a national figure. So the Ohio Republicans want to send him to the National Convention. He's smart enough to say, I don't want to go, because I'm for James G. Blaine, and my state senator, Senior Senator John Sherman, is running for the presidential nomination. I don't want to get in the middle of this. But he goes to the convention and supports Blaine, whom he had met when he was a freshman congressman. And each convention, McKinley goes and learns. And he's learned from his experiences in the state how to operate in a convention. So in 1884, he keeps the convention from going off. There's this young hothead, a pair of young hotheads, one from Massachusetts named Henry Cabot Lodge, and another 24-year-old 24-year-old assemblyman from New York named Theodore Roosevelt, and the two of them are creating havoc at the Republican convention. And McKinley calms the waters. And each convention, he gets a bigger and bigger and bigger role as a result of learning from his past experiences and acting in a manner that draws the attention and the respect and admiration of others. But yeah, he has strategic patience. Good way of describing it.
Let's ask this gentleman.
Lou Gagliano, healthcare consultant. Two real quick questions. One, did you visit the McKinley Memorial in Niles, Ohio?
And of course I did. I spoke there.
You did?
I did.
Okay, that's good. I've been it many times. Second question, when you're at the stage at the convention and when the eventual Republican candidate comes out and asks you the following question, Carl, what three things should I cover in my acceptance speech? What do you tell him?
Then or now?
Then.
Yeah. Well, then, silver. You've got to confront the currency issue. And McKinley does not, I mean, look, McKinley doesn't want to talk about it. After the Democratic convention, he thinks it's, oh, now?
Well,
this time? Okay, so that's why I ask, man. God, I was getting ready, I was sort of getting amping up there, you know. Look, first of all, we got to have a vision for the economy that is that causes people to say there's a vision for prosperity in America and that includes me. Because we live in an era of, you know, let's not pay too much attention to economic inequality. Let's pay attention to economic insecurity. You know, the Democrats want to make this about Wall Street is screwing you. We got to make this about we've got to rise. As a people, we have to do the things that are necessary to grow our economy at a stronger pace so that everybody has a piece of the action. And so people are treated fairly. But we should not make – Brian made a mistake by excoriating wealth. The Democrats will make a mistake by excoriating wealth. Second of all, safety. How are we going to keep America strong and in a dangerous world? How are we going to react? And third, and I may be wrong about this, but I think people want to have a belief that we're going to have something different. I think one of the best lines that President Obama had in his 2008 race were those things that laid the impression that he got it, that we shouldn't be red states and blue states, but United States. And I think it's going to be important for the next president and for our presidential nominee to say, look, we're all in this together. We can disagree without being disagreeable. I have respect for my political – they're not my political enemies. They're not my political adversaries. They're the loyal opposition. And we're going to find a way to move America together, forward together. And I think those three things would be important.
Okay.
Let's not ask anything more, though, about the depressing 2016 Republican
Let's see. In the front – in the second row here.
Thank you, Gerald Chandler, iTech Consultants. A great speech. How dishonest do you think politicians then were compared to now? Are we more honest?
Yeah, we are. But we're forced to be. But I got to tell you, one of the amazing things about it is the cast of characters that's running around in this era. Michael DeYoung, sort of a favorite of mine. Have you ever been in the San Francisco Art Museum? The DeYoung Art Museum. This guy was a wealthy entrepreneur, art collector. He was buying Impressionists in the 1870s and 80s for peanuts. 1916, leaves his collection to the city of San Francisco. Successful entrepreneur. Owned the San Francisco Chronicle. He's also the Republican National Committee man and a McKinley guy. So I'm reading through the minutes of the first meeting of the Republican National Committee after the convention, and they obviously elect Hannah chairman of the Republican National Committee. And I'm looking down there, and California is not Michael DeYoung. He was a National Committee man in the credentials committee meetings leading in the convention. But who's this Adolph B. Spreckles, who's the California committee man? So I did a little research. DeYoung is defeated for re-election as National Committee man on Monday, the opening day of the convention, by Adolph B. Spreckles. Shocking, because he's a McKinley man, and it's a McKinley convention, and it's a McKinley delegation. So how does he get defeated? Well, it's even weirder than that, because Adolph B. Spreckles turns out to be enormously wealthy himself. Family founded the Hawaii Sugar Company, H&I Sugar. And angered by an article in DeYoung's San Francisco Chronicle in 1884, he had confronted DeYoung in a dark alleyway and at close range shot him twice and got off of the charge of attempted murder by claiming temporary insanity. So the 18-member California delegation is sitting in a hotel room in St. Louis voting on national committee man, and by a 10-8 vote, Spreckles defeats the guy he tried to kill. Now, how weird is that? But the entire thing is populated with people like this. Daniel E. Sickles, one of my personal favorites. One of Lincoln's Union Democrat generals, whom he couldn't fire, and a complete incompetent. He's the man who, on the second day of Gettysburg, takes his corps off of Missionary Ridge and plunges it into the Devil's Den and the Peach Orchard. He loses a leg. One of his subordinates says, "The loss of his leg was a gain to us, regardless of what it was to him." And he shows up in the 1896 campaign as a Democrat, endorsing McKinley. He's a Union veteran, and he's a member of what is called by the campaign the Heroic Battalion, 40 Union generals, mostly generals, and led by Russell Alger, the former governor of Michigan, a cavalryman, led the 1st Michigan Cavalry under George Armstrong Custer at Gettysburg. And Sickles shows up to endorse McKinley and campaigns for about 8 weeks with Russell through the Midwest, and he's very funny. He's hilarious. He only got one leg, obviously. He says, "I'd like to kick Brian in my posterior, but I'll need a little help." And 13,000 people stood up and began mimicking, kicking Brian with their leg. And he's very funny. He's got a continual. You read his speeches. They're just, I couldn't put them in there because there were so many good ones, but they're just very funny. Trust me on this. He'd been elected as an assemblyman to the New York General Assembly in the early 1850s and immediately created controversy by bringing a well-known prostitute onto the floor of the New York General Assembly, where she saw some of her clients. Came to Washington after some diplomatic postings as a Democratic congressman from New York, and immediately began indulging in the great things available in Washington of the female persuasion, and got a very bad reputation. And somebody said to him, "You got to get married, or otherwise you're going to be in political trouble." So he got married to a 16-year-old who apparently was unbelievably attractive. But it didn't stop him from continuing to have affairs. So she retaliated by taking a lover of her own. And he found out about it, found out where they were meeting, and broke in on them in the act and shot her lover dead, the U.S. Attorney for the District of Columbia, Francis Scott Key, Jr., and got off by the very successful use of the first time in America of temporary insanity. And in 1896, he's campaigning for McKinley with great effect throughout the North. Anyway, it's a weird, yes, they were more honest than they were back then.
Okay, let's try a couple more. Yeah.
Thank you. Paul Bieringoff, Powerline. You mentioned the mass mailing campaign. That must have cost a lot of money. And I wouldn't be surprised if Mark Hanna spent a lot of those days, he said he wasn't. He was on the road raising money.
Yeah.
Could you talk about the role of money, not currency, but right. money in this particular yeah. election?
Yeah, well, first of all, no Federal Election Commission reports, but we do have one valuable source for this, the meticulous Mr. Dawes, who's charged by McKinley and Hanna with being responsible for every single penny of the campaign. And in his diary, he writes about this. He takes this as a very serious responsibility. In fact, he feels under a lot of pressure on this, both because he's in charge of the money and he's also in charge of the appropriate use of the money. So, for example, in the first, he writes McKinley's cousin, William McKinley Osborne, who McKinley has put in the New York headquarters to sort of be his man there. And he writes him, I've disabused all these corrupt Republicans of their ability to get money. We're bidding everything out. And then he sends reports to McKinley and Hanna about every single penny. So we know the exact amount that was spent through the Chicago headquarters. It's $1.9 million. But he literally has it down to the penny. And then there's about $1.5 million spent out of the New York headquarters, which is mainly just grants to state party organizations where they write them a check to pay for their local activities. The Democrats raised about $500,000. Now, that's not what historians claim the Republicans raised. If you look at the progressive historians of the 1920s and 30s, they suggest that the Republican campaign was $13 to $15 million, which is inaccurate. There's no evidence whatsoever for that. Contradicted, look, Dawes is his entirely credible source. I mean, if somebody had said to him lie, he would have said, you cur, and belted him. So, on the other hand, we really don't know how much politics cost back then, because a lot of it was done at the local level. We have these vast armies of people who work in politics, and a lot of it gets paid for at the local level, and a lot of it is volunteer as well. So we really don't know. But look, history is replete with lots of people who spent a lot more money and lost. Money is not the only reason that McKinley won. It's the appropriate and effective use of the money. I mean, Dawes is sitting there saying, how can I economize? I'm gonna print a train car loads of material, but by God, we're gonna competitively bid it. They also do, though, have the first micro-targeting. The canvas, particularly in the Midwest states, yields a list of about 5 million households that are considered doubtful households. So they have a room in the Chicago headquarters with 100 women, and every week in the fall, which I take to be, I can't get the exact nature of this, but it looks like it's the last 6 weeks, they sit down and every week hand address 5 million envelopes, stuff them with material, stamp them, and mail them in the last 4, 5, 6 weeks of the campaign. So, you know, a lot of things that we take for granted now, they actually started then.
Okay. Let's get one question at the back, and that will be the last one.
Hi, Mr. Rove. My name is Jack Sinko. I'm a student at Hillsdale College, working here for the semester at the Republican Study Committee.
A Lawrence Arn man.
Yes. My question is about Mark Hanna. I was wondering if Senator Hanna would have any modern-day tips for a 2016 campaign manager. I know he ran an exemplary ground game in McKinley's campaign.
Look, here's the deal. He wouldn't have good advice. All his advice in the general election turned out to be bad. I'd want to be knowing what Charles G. Dawes has to say to somebody today. I'd want to know what Major McKinley would have, because McKinley is the architect of his own campaign. I mean, they acknowledged it. I mean, John Hay went to see McKinley, and he was a huge fan of McKinley. He said, let me see, I wrote it in here. I spent the day with the major. He spells it M-A-J-A-H. And there are idiots who think Mark Hanna will run him, he says to Henry Adams. I mean, the guy who's running the campaign, who's making the big right decisions, is McKinley. Hanna is the fundraiser extraordinaire in the general election. But even then, you know how much of that $3.5 million they'd raised by the end of August? $111,000. They'd raised $500,000 by the end of September. They raised most of this money in October. So even then, they were helped by the events, by the campaign getting itself in the right place and starting to say the right thing. And McKinley performing in a way that contrasted sharply and effectively with Brian. Now, you're from Hillsdale, so I'm gonna. You didn't ask this question, but I'm going to close because of your president is a friend of mine, and you go back and tell him this, because he'll like this. Everybody shows up in this campaign. Anybody who is anybody in America shows up. And even if you aren't in America, you sometimes show up. And one of my favorite characters is a minor character in this drama, but plays an important role, Burke Cochran. Burke Cochran is a Democrat, a Tammany Hall Democrat. And he's not particularly unusual, except in one respect. He's sort of average looking, about 5'10", a little bit taller than normal, but 5'10", Irish born, sort of bulky, not overly so, but sort of bulky, not very, you know, not an impressive face, just sort of a normal face. But when he talked, men wanted to be his friend and women wanted to be his lover. He had this Irish baritone and was an unbelievable speaker, unbelievable orator. Was, as a result, not only very effective in Congress, but was one of New York's best lawyers. He was, if you had a jury trial, you wanted Burke Cochran. Well, he'd taken a lover in 1894, a British aristocratic widow who's living most of the time in Paris. And so he was out of Congress, and he made a lot of money as a lawyer, and he spent a lot of time in Paris in the arms of his lover. And He was back in the United States in 1895. Her 19-year-old son came through New York on his way to Cuba, where he was going to be a war correspondent. And the two men became close friends. And then in April of 1896, he breaks his leg and goes back to recuperate in the arms of his lover in Paris, and then breaks off the affair in August and returns home. And sends word to the press that they ought to meet him at dockside. He's got something interesting to say. And so he arrives. There's the press gathered around to see what Mr. Cochran has to say. And he says, I'm a Democrat. I'm a Tammany Hall man. I'm a Tammany man, a loyal Democrat. But I'm also an honest money man. So I cannot support the Chicago platform or the Chicago nominee. So at my own expense, under the auspices of the Honest Money League, I will travel the country and ask like-minded Democrats to join me in voting for William McKinley. This is unheard of. This is not done. This is like bang, big explosion. This is like John Connally saying, I was Lyndon Johnson's fair-haired boy, but McGovern is too left of me. I can't be for him. I'm for Nixon. And it's headlines all across the country. And Brian is about ready to arrive in New York to give his acceptance speech, which he does. And so all the honest money Democrats and Republicans call on Cochran to respond a week later, and he does so in a magnificent speech at Madison Square Garden. And you read the speech, and even 120 years different distance, you say, God, this guy was good. Particularly if you can read one of the versions where they show laughter, applause, cheers. You can see, you can just hear the crowd responding to these things that he did. 1.5 hours without a single note. At the end of it, the easy boss, the leader of the New York Republicans, Thomas Collier Platt, says the election is over. We have won. Now, not true. They had three more hard months of fight to go, but it was a magnificent speech, and he spends the rest of the campaign traveling the country and methodically stripping away gold Democrats by saying, look at me, I'm going for McKinley, you can too. But the speech is reprinted in the London newspapers where it's read by the son of his lover, who writes him, immediately telegraphs him. It was a great moral victory, he says, a great moral victory. I hope it has an enormous effect. Devotedly yours, Winston Spencer Churchill. In 1947, Churchill gives the Iron Curtain speech, and one of his admirers writes him and says, you are the greatest orator of our century. And he writes him back and says, no, I am not. He said, quote, Burke Cochran inspired me when I was 19 and taught me how to use every note of the human voice like an organ. He was my model. Everybody shows up. Thanks for coming.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Carl. And before we go, I want to mention that our next Bradley lecture will be given by Larry Mead on February 27th on culture and its effect on American life. He's following some of our previous Bradley lectures in years past, Francis Fukuyama and Samuel Huntington. So I hope many of you will come here again. But thanks to Carl very much. Books are available outside, and he will be signing books at the table here. So. Thanks again to Karl Rove. Okay. Brilliant. We really come alive here. This is...